Hey guys, welcome back to Kerbal Space Program, or as I like to call it nowadays, Kerbal Broke Program, because I am out of money. Though we do have a glorious space station up in low Kerbin orbit, doing absolutely nothing to bring me money. But I think we can solve this. Well, not so much solve the space station, but I think we can solve my lack of funds. Because if we come in here, we have two contracts that both earn me, you know, hundreds of thousands. Oh, not quite. Not quite. Together, they will earn me 150,000-ish, which I think is a good chunk to be going with. And the reason I think these two will work so well together is I need to put a satellite in equatorial orbit around the moon, though I think it is a retrograde orbit. The inclination is 180 degrees, 90 would be polar, and 180 is backwards, right? I don't know. We'll figure that one out. And then this one is science data from space around the moon. We can do that. We can do it, transmit or recover. So it has to be like transmittable stuff. So we're not going to be doing the goo or the materials, babe. But we're going to be doing stuff. So what we're going to do, we're going to grab this and grab this. Boom. Job done. Yeah. Thumbs up, Kerb. Kerb? Gene. Wow. Having troubles today. Also want to go have a look in this science bay, not just because I've got like 240 science from doing all those rubbish contracts last time, but also because I want to go to the science archives, look in Kerbin and the moon, and see where what space science is left to get. So like there's three reports here as opposed to four here. I mean, magnetometer, EVA, EVA. Ah, but it's the EVA reports, right? EVA crew report. Okay, so we've got no magnetometer data here. So that could be got. Also, maybe the multispectral scanning, that could also be got. What we'll have to do is go and have a look at our science. But first, before we do all that, I'm going to buy this because this gives us some air intakes. And we'll never have the trouble that we had last time again if we buy some air intakes. Honest, never. And also right here, I'm going to buy some legs and some landing gear. Done. Gone. Okay, right, so we've got another 64 left. That's not enough to spend on any of these. In fact, that is 100 short. So let's not talk about the rest of this, and let's go try and make a science satellite. And here we have it, a tiny, tiny little machine perched on top of my Betsy launcher, the one we used to go to the moon last time. Though, for some reason, yet again, we don't have any separatrons on the boosters. So I try and spin up to throw them away, but that didn't go particularly well. But that's all right, because we seem to have blown off the furthest ones up the asparagus line, if you see what I'm saying. They'll be the ones that get dropped the first, which is fine. We can deal with that. We throw the second away at the appropriate staging point. And it's about here that I realised that I have got far, far too much fuel for the mission that I had intended to do. Even with the exploding sort of like, what, sixth of my fuel? Maybe a third of my fuel? Kind of just got thrown away to the atmosphere. We still have more than enough. In fact, with the explosion, the asparagus seems to be almost bang on. Because here we are circularising our orbit. And just before we come out of the atmosphere, perfect little separation there. So those are going to go crashing down. And we're left with the main lift stage in the middle and an interplanetary stage. I really wish I'd left that interplanetary stage off now. A quick check of how I need to set up my orbit. It was indeed in a retrograde around the moon. And now I go and do some... Well, I thought if I just got it so I was flying up towards the moon, I'd be able to kind of put myself into a figure of eight around the front of the moon and kind of go in like that. Though for some reason I thought that this would happen if I just went up and just kind of touched the orbit and then like this bit here and then followed the yellow line and then we could get it in a nice circular orbit like that. I don't know why I thought this would work. Obviously with hindsight I realized that what I should have done is go up higher so I'm behind the moon and then do my orbital jiggery pokery up there at that point. As it is, we kind of just have to deal with the burn that's going on, but it gives me a chance to talk about this MOHO window coming up here now, let alone the fact that it's going to take me 2 days to do this mission. I am not in the position money wise to send anything to MOHO. Lander, probe, satellite, nothing will really have the, well, I won't have the money to throw anything up there. So we're going to wait till the next Moho window, which should be all right. And hopefully we'll have a contract for there by then, because at the moment we don't. All right, so I'm just mucking around with the alarm clock, trying to make sure that when I cross the sphere of influence, I don't end up like massively out of proportion of where I thought I was. Not so important on this moon mission, but it's just nice to keep in practice with this. And we just kind of like come down and go, yep, fair enough. Skip through, perfect. Now it's at this point that I realise something has gone hideously wrong. Well, it's not at this point, it's when I check my map next, which should hopefully be right now. I'm like, ah, that's not going the right way. This is just going to pass in front of the moon, because of course the moon is travelling faster than me. It's been up here, it's used to it, like I've got all sorts of weird things to go on, so I'm going to be moving slower than the moon. That's right, just a short bit of boosting around and just kind of firing off in different directions. I mean, I've got loads of fuel to play with here, so I thought, hey, I'll just figure out how this works. Had a few issues where, like, I think now's going to happen there, because I'm so high up in the moon's sphere of influence, it's very easy to push myself off and out. But that's all right, we'll just wait some time, sort out some manoeuvre nodes. I go down and find the bit where I'm going to cross this projected path of where I'm supposed to be, and then spend a lot of time mucking around with this manoeuvre node, trying to get it to match up exactly. Takes me a little while to realise, of course, I'm a little far out of the plane to be able to do this properly, but it's okay. We'll get close, we'll get the periapsis in place, and then from there we should be able to tweak our apoapsis to give us the right place. More alarm clock settings. That a lot of this was all done with alarm clock, because, well, as you have probably noted in a few of my past episodes, if I don't set these alarm clocks, I just go flying past the point of where I'm supposed to be. Alright, so this manoeuvre was a little bit sketchy. You can see right now I'm kind of just plummeting down towards the moon, and so I decide now is the good time to fine-tune my manoeuvre node. I don't know why I thought now was a good time for this. It was not. Let me just point that out. It really wasn't. I could have done with doing it after we had circularised and made sure we weren't going to smash into the moon. But that's alright. I mean, whatever. I mean, so there we can see the separation between my current orbit and where I need to be. It's quite a lot. It's quite a lot. Though it turns out that after I've set this up and started figuring out where my next maneuver mode could be, just to make sure that I get bang on the money, it's actually all right. So, you know, I'm not happy with that, of course. Like, it's gonna tell me very shortly that I've been neutralized for 10 seconds and everything is fine, but I don't want to do that. I want to have a perfectly equatorial orbit, goddammit. Excuse me. And to that end, we're going to cruise around and just wait until we get close. So there we go. You can see, for some reason, it decided that whilst I was time warping was the brilliant time to set that to say I'm perfectly done. But there we go. And then, trying to get rid of all the debris, I go and mess up my orbit by pressing the shift key at the wrong time. I don't know why I thought shift was a good thing to do that, and I don't know why I thought burning retrograde would be a good way to fix that. It just all went a little bit wrong at that point. So I'll go and balance out my periapsis and apoapsis and try and decide what to do with these things here. I decide that I'm just going to leave them in orbit. Ideally, I would have put a probe core on them and sorted them out that way. But I was like, we'll leave them in orbit. We can come round, get some fuel lines hooked up at some point and use them as a fuel source. But there we go. We've got a tiny little satellite. I really like the design of this, actually. It's just, what is it? It's a probe core with a couple of tiny fuel tanks top and bottom, tiny engine to maneuver, and then some nice little stuff on top just to get all the science that we need to complete the second contract that I had intended to do. Then we set the scan sat off and take our orbit into a slightly less equatorial thing so we don't just end up with a band of map. Okay, so coming back, I'd found a second contract to do for Gene. He wanted me to go and do a flyby mission on quite a lot of different areas of waypoints. And having purchased all the plane parts, I thought, hey, what better time to go out and do some low atmospheric flying? Because, you know, who does that in the stock game? And yeah, away we go. Bob is taking the controls nowadays, mainly because we've killed Bill. I know I said it was Bob a while ago, but that's because for some reason I just couldn't read my screen. But yeah, we've killed Bill, so Bob has to take over. Jeb is currently up in the wagon wheel, if you're wondering. And I think we're going to do this flight in the form of several montages as we go across and get these different waypoints. First, we need to be able to see where all these waypoints are. Fortunately, I only have this very short piece of footage to show you here, which I have slowed down for your convenience. I'm heading for these purple way markers here. You can see they're just in the mountains to the north of the KSP, of the Kerbal Space Center, and then further up about quarter of the way around the planet. Now, my theory for flying was fairly standard. I went up to about 10 kilometers. I flew along as far as I could, only 10 kilometers because that's what my engine would lift me to because I'm still quite early into this atmospheric flight malarkey. And as soon as it tells me I was close, I would nosedive down, grab the data, fly across to the next point, whether up high or down low, depending on how far we had to go, and then do some flying around in some mountains. Now, the problem with this plan is, whilst it was a lot of fun for me flying around and doing this, I mean, look at the shots like this, they're absolutely amazing. It's not for the best sort of constant video stream, post-commentary type videos. Yeah, that sentence definitely made sense. So what we're going to do is cut forward to my landing, about here. I'd gone round, I'd done all the waypoints at this point, and we're just coming in for a land. Now, one thing you may or may not notice is that my landing gear on my back here are facing what I would consider the wrong way round. That is, with the wheels to the front of the vessel. I had to do that for lifting purposes. I'm sure, as some of you will know, if you have your landing gear too far back and try and pivot on them, your plane just won't lift. It took me forever to figure out just to turn my landing gear around. I don't know why. We had to go off and do some testing because this thing just wouldn't lift off the floor. But now we get to witness how bad I am at landing. Like, I'm close to the floor and bounce and skip. I do a lot of bouncing and skipping for some reason. This just seems to be my landing style. But there we go. That is another contract complete. This puts me up. Well, when we did the moon satellite, that put us up to the pre-space station funding level. We had 150,000. At the end of this, I believe I am closer to 200,000. We'll have to check the numbers at the end. I can't quite remember off the top of my head. But as this is the end of the mission, I'm going to say thank you very much for joining me for this one. I have had a blast doing it. I know there's not been a great deal of footage to cover, but you know, that's the nature of commercialism, I suppose, that stuff being done for the sake of money, not for the sake of entertainment. I will see you next time, where hopefully we're not going to be doing more commercial stuff, because even though commercial stuff is fun for me playing, it's not great fun for you guys watching. I don't think. If you disagree with me, let me know. Maybe we can cover it in a slightly different way somehow. I'm not sure at all. Yeah, but we'll see you then when maybe we're going to Juno. No, that's still ages off on the thing. I know, we'll find something to do, and I will see you then when we're going to do that. Bye-bye!